بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين أبي القاسم محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد، وعجل فرجهم ولعن أعداؤهم أجمعين من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين. السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. Last night we spoke about the concept of love, and especially when it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we gave reasons to why one should be loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we don't want to go over the topic again. From that love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we get to generate another love. So when we love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we're going upwards from our hearts to Allah. Once we reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we reach the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that love has to project backwards. So we need to go down. And then we use the love we gain for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to work with it amongst the servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where our dealings with people, our interactions with people and with things around us, it has to be based on the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and no one else. Not based on what I feel, not based on what makes me happy, not based on how I view things, but how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala views them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when you look at things, when you look at people, if the person that you're looking at is the person, a servant of mine that pleases me, then that person you should love. If a person disobeys me, then that person you should hate. So the core center of a human being, or the core of his heart, is the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and through that we deal with other people. As you can see that in our current civilization, or in our current day, and the countries that we live in, the concept of racism, it pretty much exists within every single nation that we have today. However, Islam, when Islam came, Islam abolished the concept of racism. Islam said there is no such a thing as racism amongst humans. Why? For a number of reasons, one of which is that we all came from the same origin. We all were created out of mud. It's not like one of us was made out of gold and one of them made out of diamond and the rest are lower class. No, in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we were all created equal from the same material. Two, we came from the same biological parents. If we had to go back to Adam and Hawa, or Adam and Eve, they were our father and mother. So we all originated from the same source. When we look at each other now, on number three, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us all the same faculties. What I have is what you have. It's not like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you an extra hand, or Allah gave you an extra eye and he gave me less. No, Allah gave us the same. Based on these things, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that when you deal with people, when you look at people, you have to look at them from that concept, that they are equal to you. And this is the famous quote of Amir al-Mu'mineen, where he says, people are of two kind, either a brother in faith or equal in humanity. That's it, there's no more, no less. So when I come and I'm trying to put myself above others because either my race is superior, so to say I'm a white person, so I'm superior to those who are black, or because I come from, let's say, a special tribe, therefore my surname has a special, tone to it that no one has, or my bank account is a lot bigger than yours, or my house is more fancier than yours, or my car is more faster than yours. These things to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means nothing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says at the end of the day, you both came from the same source and you both go to the same source. If you visit a graveyard, you'll find the king and a servant, they're equal. The king dies with nothing, he takes nothing with him but his kafan, his cloth, and he gets buried. And the servant is exactly next to him with the same thing. So why do we give ourselves the right to make ourselves superior to others. So then it came to the question, how do we deal with other people then? You know, because if you look back before the Islamic era and you look at the nations before Islam, they used to subject people based on their color, based on their race, and they used to deal with them on that regard. If they're black, they make them servants, they make them slaves. And sadly, the concept of slavery still exists until our time now. Or because you're for example, from a certain continent, therefore you look down under. Because you're, for example, Asian or European or African or what have you, you've been classified. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He brought the message of Islam, He said, no, all these things has to go. The only thing that remains is that when you look at people, you have to look at them based on their nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't matter their color, it doesn't matter their race. And the classical example that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us was Karbala, where you see Imam Hussein salamullah alayhi, him being an imam, being appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being the divine appointed leader of mankind, being the one who is infallible, who is sinless, being the one that is most knowledgeable, being the one, he is the best in everything that there is to be. Yet, when he deals with people, and when he looks at his companions, if you look at the Battle of Karbala, he had the servants, black servants, they were serving him. Yet, when they got martyred, he comes and he puts his face on their face, his cheek on their cheek, right? And he brings himself to that state. When his son, Ali al-Akbar, the one that looks exactly like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, in his akhlaq and his morals and in his looks, the Imam salamullah alayhi does the exact same thing. When he had a Christian amongst his army, he did not say, well, he's a Christian, I'm a Muslim, or he just became a Muslim, therefore let's treat him differently. No, he treated him the same. When he looks at those who were, for example, came from Turkey, or Romans, he classified them to be the same, equal as his other companions. When he looked at the old ones, he treated them the exactly same way that he treated the young ones. And so on and so forth. So you see, in the Battle of Karbala, the Imam Salamullah alayhi, the way he dealt with his companions, even though they were different, even some of them, they came, they joined the Imam army at the last minute, like Al-Hur, for example. Al-Hur, even though he, from the beginning, he gave the Imam a very hard time, and you know, he forced him not to go to Kufa, and he made him go to Karbala, and this and that. And Hur, just moments before the battle starts, he had a change of heart, he came to the Imam. And the Imam salamullah alayhi didn't say to him, okay, you know what, Hur, you were so bad to us, and you gave us such a hard time, we're not gonna accept you. He said, no. He said, if you accept Allah and you repent to Allah, then you are amongst us, then you are one of us. So the idea is that Islam, when Islam came, it came with a global message. That is, if you want to deal with people, your dealing has to be based on the love and hate of Allah. We have to love those who love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, regardless of their color, race, or language. And we have to hate those who hate Allah, regardless of their color, race, or language, or even if they are family members. Look at what the Quran says. Allah says, لَا تَجِدُ قَوْمًا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. You will not find a group of people who believe in Allah and the day or the hereafter. يُوَادُونَ مَنْ حَدَّ اللَّهِ. Those people who believe in Allah and the day or the hereafter, you will never find them loving or taking friends of those who are enemies to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's one. وَرَسُولُهُ. And his messenger. Because there are those who acclaim that we love Allah, but we don't like the messenger. It doesn't work. Because even among the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there were a lot of hypocrites. There were Muslims on the outside, but yet they've done a lot of crimes towards the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, towards the Muslims. So those ones, regardless of what they acclaim, they are still the enemies of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then Allah says, وَلَوْ كَانُوا آبَاؤُهُمْ وَأَبْنَاؤُهُمْ وَأَخْوَانَهُمْ وَعَشِرَتُهُمْ. Even if those people that needs to be hated, even they were their fathers, their brothers, their sons, and their tribes. Because he's my father, I say, you know what? He's my father, I gotta love him, even though he hates Allah and he hates the messenger. In Allah's dictionary, that does not work. He says, if you believe in Allah and the hereafter, those people, you cannot take them as companions, you cannot take them as friends, you cannot take them as friends of yours. Why? Because they hate Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ كَتَبَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمِ الْإِيمَانِ وَأَيَّدَهُمْ بِرُوحٍ مِّنْهِ. Those who hate for Allah and love for Allah, he says, Allah has written or has prescribed belief and iman in their hearts. Allah has instated belief and iman in their heart. And then he says, وَيَدْخُلُهُمْ جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward them with heavens that rivers flows under it. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا. They will remain for eternity. رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ رَضُوا عَنْهُ. Allah was pleased with them and they are pleased with Allah. And you see how much Allah glorifies those who deal with people based on the concept of love and hate for him, of course. And then he says, أُولَٰئِكَ حُزْبُ اللَّهِ. Those are the army of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَلَا أَنَّ حُزْبَ اللَّهُمَ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Surely are the army or the party of Allah are those who are successful, those who will succeed. So you see how much Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave this group of people so much merits, and he gave them so much bounties and so much blessings just for using the concept of love and hate for his sake. So sometimes if you find yourself in a community or in a group of people where, for example, you come to the masjid, you see different colors in the masjid. You see the black, the white, the brown, the yellow. You see the Arab, the Greek, I don't know, the Asian, the African. When you look at them and you see, and the only thing that you see is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you are among those people. When you look at them and say, you know what, he's black, I better stay away. He's Asian, I better stay away. He's, I don't know, I better stay away. Then you have a problem. Then we have a problem. Because what? We're not going according to the Hizbullah. We're not going according to the party of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We become members who are outcasted out of this party. So as long as we want to remain in this party, then the way we view each other based on what? Love for Allah and hate for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And sadly, sometimes when we deal with each other, I've seen this many times, that sometimes you have people what? Less, you know, from, I use my own words, they're not cute enough. They're not good looking, right? He's a good believing man and woman, and they're practicing and they fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But because their looks does not satisfy your desire, like, all right, you know, I don't like the way he looks. His nose is crooked and his mouth is, I don't know what, and his face has got, you know, certain things. Therefore, my heart says, I don't like this person. This is a satanic idea, a satanic thought, to hate a believing person based on his looks, or to reject a mu'min based on his looks. Sometimes a person comes to you and he asks you for help and you refuse because you don't like the way he looks or you don't like him. When a kafir, an unbeliever, comes to you because he looks good, because he's a curer, he's like, oh, you know, you go out of your way to please him and to do things for him. If that happens, then we have to understand that we are not amongst what? The party of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yet we are actually in the party of shaitan, in the hizb of shaitan. In the same way Allah has a hizb and has a party and has members, shaitan has a party and has members. When I find in my heart that I have a bit of hate towards certain communities, towards certain people, because of their color, because of their race, even though they are Muslims, even though they are believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then I have a problem. So this, we need to get rid of this. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he says, أَوْثَقُ عُرَى الْإِيمَانِ الْحُبُّ فِي اللَّهِ وَالْبُغْضُ فِي اللَّهِ. He says the strongest, how should I put this? He says the strongest handle a one could hold on to is the love for the sake of Allah and the hate for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One day the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he said to his companions, he said, tell me, which is amongst the Islamic actions that is the most, let's say, the strongest, or the one that is the firmest? So some of them said, they said salah, and some said zakah, either prayer or giving charity, and some said jihad. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, فقال يا رسول الله فأخبرنا. He said to them, no. So he said, okay, tell us. Then he said, He said, الحب في الله والبغض في الله. The strongest thing that a person could hold on to amongst the Islamic concepts, amongst the Islamic actions, is the love in Allah and the hate in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because there is no point of salah. You pray, but you hate. How does that work? Because salah, as we said many times, تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر. It, the salah's job to prevent you from committing is to prevent you from creating havoc and mischief on earth and corruption, transgression towards Allah. It's meant to do that to you. But how come you are praying but yet you have hate? Because hate causes corruption. So your salah is not going anywhere. How is it when you come to charity, for example, you give charity, you only give to those whom you like, those whom you love, not those who Allah loves. For example, you have two poor people. One could be from different communities, like, you know what, I'm not going to give him because I better give, you know, those because I don't like these people. It doesn't work. It's not accepted. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam, he was trying to bring their minds to this concept that even salah, even siyam, even jihad, if it's not done for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the love of Allah and the hate of Allah, then there's no point in them. So even jihad itself, it has to be done for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then we said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبُبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so Allah's talking on the mouth of the Prophet, he says, if you acclaim to love Allah, then follow me first, then Allah will love you. How do we follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? We follow his sunnah. The sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi is that he treated his companions exactly the same. Regardless of their color, regardless of their country, regardless of their language, they were all treated the same in the presence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi. You had Sahib al-Rumi, he was from Roman. He was treated the same. Bilal Habashi was from Abyssinia. He was a black servant. To the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi, he was treated the same. Salman al-Muhammad, he was from Persia. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam, he treated him the same. And all the companions, he never at once said, you know what, you are from a different place, therefore we're going to give you less. He didn't work. Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullah alayhi, even when Talha and Zubayr, they came to him, when Amir al-Mu'mineen was the Khalifa of his time, and Talha and Zubayr, so Amir al-Mu'mineen divided the house, the money in the house, the treasury among the mu'mins, the believers. Talha and Zubayr came to him. They said to him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, how could you give the Persians more than us when we are from the tribe of Quraysh? We are higher class. And Amir al-Mu'mineen, salamullah alayhi, he paused for a minute. He says, you know what? Last time I checked, everyone was made from mud. So what makes you a higher class? What makes you think that you're better than the Persians? And last time I checked, we were all the sons of Adam and Eve. So why should you be treated differently? So then again, we come back to the concept that we need to deal with people and treat people based on the fact that we are the same in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If I acclaim that I love Allah and Allah is in my heart, then I should see everybody based on that love I have in my heart. If I start to differentiate between people, between the believing men and believing women, based on my own desires, then I have to understand that Allah's love is not in my heart. Because you cannot have your love and Allah's love in the same heart. We have a hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam, where it's the hadith Qudsi. He says, Allah says, the heavens and the earth could not contain me, but the heart of my believing person, or the heart of the believing person, contained me. So Allah resides in the hearts of the believers. And only Allah's love, not my love. And you guys remember that when we spoke about the hadith of Imam Sadiq salamullah alayhi, where he was talking, always glorifying Salman al-Muhammadi. And this guy said to him, why are you always glorifying Salman? What's so special about Salman? And he says, Salman always put the hawa of Amir al-Mu'mineen, the pleasure of Amir al-Mu'mineen, before his own, which is the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we, at all the times, we need to have Allah first before us. You guys all remember the story of Amir al-Mu'mineen, salamallahu alayhi, in the battle of Khandaq, where he came to behead Amr ibn Wud, and the guy spat in the face of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Amir al-Mu'mineen, he paused and he walked. He walked away and then he came back and then he finished the job. When they asked him, what did you do that for? He says, because the minute he spat on my face, I got angry. So if I would have done anything in that moment, I would have done it for my sake, not for Allah's sake. So I went back, I cooled down a bit, then I finished the job for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we see here the trend is what? That we have to deal with everything based on the fact that is the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why, for example, in the dua we say, Allahumma arzqni hubbaka wa hubba man yuhubbik, man yuhubbak. Oh Allah, grant me, give me your love and the love of those who love you. Because you can't just say it's one-sided love, it's one-way love. It has to be two ways. You have to go towards Allah and then back from Allah to His servants. حُبَّكَ وَحُبَّ مَنْ يُحُبِّكَ. Make me love you and make me love those who love you. Okay? Because this is how, at the end of the way, this is how it works. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, he says, لَا يُؤْمِنُ عَبْدٌ حَتَّى أَكُونُ أَحَبُّ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ نَفْسَهِ. He says, a person will not become a believer until I become more beloved to him than himself. وَأَهْلِي أَحَبُّ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ أَهْلَهِ. And my household are more beloved to him than his own household. وَأَتْرَتِي أَحَبُّ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ أَتْرَتَهِ. And my lineage is more beloved to him than his lineage. وَذَاتِي أَحَبُّ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ ذَاتِهِ. And my essence is more beloved to him than my essence. Which means what? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi says, we, the Ahlul Bayt, we represent Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth. The Prophet and the Ahlul Bayt are the representatives of Allah on earth. So if we love the Ahlul Bayt, if we love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, who are we loving? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we have this immense love for Imam Hussein, when we have this crazy love for Imam Hussein, and we love him and we don't know why. It's just insane. It's just insanity, a level of insanity when it comes to Imam Hussein. Why? What does this originate from? Is Imam Hussein my cousin? Is he my friend? Has he paid me cash? Why do we come every year, we mourn for him, we cry for him, we lament for him and all this? For what? What did he give us? Nothing. It is only because he represents Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we love him for what he did for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's how we should work, not only with Imam Hussein salamullah alayhi, but with everyone else. That's how we should deal with everybody else based on the fact that we love for Allah and we hate for Allah. So especially in this month of Ramadan, and let me finish with this. When you look into your heart, and you have to, I said this many times, you have to be your own doctor when it comes to your moral sins. Look inside your heart and see, do you have hatred towards a group of people, towards a friend, towards someone who believes in Allah, towards especially if the person who is even a Shi'i, for example, a follower of Amir al-Mu'mineen? If you find in your heart that there might be a bit of animosity, a bit of hatred towards them, then you have to understand there is a problem. And that problem needs to be fixed. Right? And one of the companions of the Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, Allah, he used to make a beautiful dua. He says, oh Allah, please, anyone who is a Shia of Amir al-Mu'mineen, whatever he does to me, like for example, takes my right, backbites me, whatever bad he does for me, oh Allah, forgive him for the sake of Amir al-Mu'mineen. So this is how we need to grow out of this, our inner ego. Just me, my race and my people and my community. No, as long as you are a mu'min, as long as you are believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you believe in the hereafter, your life should process and should work based on the fact that I love for Allah and I hate for Allah. Whoever loves Allah, I will love them. Whoever hates Allah, I will hate them. That's it. No races, no boundaries, no colors, no nothing. Either Allah or no. That's it. So then again, so in this month of Ramadan, we need to cleanse our hearts, we need to back and reflect. So inshallah, by the time this month finishes, we have achieved something. At least we have managed to cleanse our hearts from this moral diseases that we might have. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wa salatu wa salam ala Muhammadin wa ali baytihi at-tayyibin at-tahirin.